Hello, and thank you for joining me on this surprisingly sunny Thursday evening. This is my first time doing a design talk, so I'm hoping you can come away with having learned a little something new about web accessibility, in particular WCAG 2.2. But first, let me introduce myself. My name is Jadie, a user experience designer at Jardu, and I'm passionate about inclusive design and sharing tips to boost your UX career. You can find me on YouTube and Twitter, at Hello Jadine, and I'm a lover of all things tech, design, or dessert related. Just to give you a little overview of my talk, this talk is about the importance of web accessibility and how to prepare for the upcoming changes in WCAG 2.2. I'm going to give an overview of web accessibility, explain what WCAG is, and how to prepare for the upcoming changes. So let's begin with web accessibility. Web accessibility is the practice of removing barriers from websites that could hinder functionality for users with various disabilities. It includes implementing things like adding closed captions to videos and making sure there is enough contrast between different elements on a device or a website for users with visual impairments. I have some statistics that I'd like to share with you, but to make this talk a little bit more interactive, I'm going to run two polls to see if you're aware how many different people or the amount of people that are affected by varying disabilities and why it's important we as designers, developers, in fact, everyone collaboratively works together to make digital products which are accessible. So, I'm hoping that this will work smoothly because I was not able to get this running on Zoom. So I have opted for using straw poll, which you will have been sent a link to earlier. So beginning with poll one, please feel free to get your votes rolling in. How many people experience some sort of permanent or temporary disability? That's with either vision, hearing, or motion out of the statistics below. Now, as this is multiple choice, you've been sent this in advance, I'm hoping that all the results are in. So if I click the results tab, we will see that the majority of you have voted for 1 in 20. So if I just pull this to one side, I can reveal that it is in fact 1 in 5. So that is in fact higher than what 67% of you had thought. So just to keep the ball rolling with that line of thought, I have a second poll, which is on an even larger scale. So according to the World Health Organization, known as WHO, in 2011, their World Report on Disabilities, what percent of the world's population possess some sort of disability? So I believe you will have the link sent through. So this is varying between 4, 10, 12, and 15%. If I just go to results. Okay, this is, you're aiming quite high here. You're judging between 15 and 12%, with 15 being the highest. And I can reveal that you are correct. It is in fact 15% of the world population that have some form of disability. Now this includes physical disabilities as well as cognitive and neurological, and the rates of disability are only set to increase due to the population aging and there being increases in chronic health conditions, which leads me on to my second point of the talk. Why is web accessibility important? The polls that we've just run highlight the amount of people who have disabilities, so that in itself is a case for, you know, providing access to our various digital products. So as stated, 15% of the world's population have some form of disability, and there are also temporary disabilities that we can consider, such as if a person were to break their fingers, for instance, painful, but that would make them unable to use their phone or maybe a laptop in the usual way of typing. So they would need an alternative. And as mentioned, as the world's population live longer and get older, we're likely to see more age-related disabilities, such as vision impairment. So web accessibility increases the range of audience that you can reach. And it's important to do that. Legal compliance. So let's talk about legal compliance here. Depending on the nature of your website, you may be legally required to comply with web accessibility standards. Several nations, including the US, Canada, the EU, and the UK, currently have web accessibility laws. And it's likely that we will see more countries adopting such laws, especially for websites in the public sector. Not complying with web accessibility laws could cost you. Now, flipping over to the next slide, this is a screenshot from an article published on gov.uk, and that states that it's constantly being updated, this article, but from the Monday, the 23rd of September 2019, public sectors launched on or after the 23rd of September 2018 must meet accessibility standards. So that's WCAG AA. This includes publishing web accessibility statements and explaining how accessible their websites are. So the deadline for public sector organisations to make all existing websites accessible is the 23rd of September 2020. So depending on when you're watching this video, the laws could be in place, and the compliance date for the mobile application is the 23rd of June 2021. So legal compliance is important, and there are rules and regulations out there that you need to adhere to. Web accessibility also improves website quality. So following web accessibility standards won't just help people with disabilities, but make your website more accessible for all users. And it may have SEO benefits as well. For example, using alt text will help people who have visual impairments. It'll help those users understand images if they're using something such as a screen reader, but it is also very important for SEO and people using image search when images fail to render. So that's a win-win. And finally, it's the right thing to do. For years and years, people with disabilities were kind of at the edge of society as they didn't have access to basic services. And even today, with many laws and regulations for accessibility, disabled people still may find themselves excluded in different ways from society. And it may be difficult to participate in daily life because we have put these barriers up by building inaccessible products. But the web has opened many doors for people with various disabilities. And thanks to things such as screen readers, blind people have greater independence when reading articles online. And for people who are unable to speak, they can still participate in debates and discussions in online forums and chat rooms. Web accessibility, all in all, is morally the right thing to do. Because it has so many other benefits for your website, the best practices associated with it, and improves SEO, there's no reason why you shouldn't improve web accessibility to allow disabled people, all people, to take full advantage of what the web has to offer. Now, I know you've heard me mention WCAG quite a bit, so let me just break down what WCAG is. Web accessibility is measured against the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, known as WCAG. These are written by the World Wide Web Consortium, W3C, which is the abbreviations that many people use to talk about these two bodies. And W3C are the organization who manage web standards. And as I often say in simple terms, if you adhere to the WCAG guidelines, you can ensure that your digital product will be accessible. Now, WCAG guidelines are categorized into three levels of conformance in order to meet the needs of different groups in different situations, with A being the lowest, AA being a mid-range compliance, and AAA being the highest, creme de la creme. So conformance at the higher levels, such as AAA, AA, indicates that you conform at a lower level. And why is WCAG changing? Well, when WCAG was released, think about the technology like 10 years ago. Phones have not stayed the same. They continue to improve, laptops get faster, thinner, and technology changes with time. So as we're continually improving technology, the guidelines which we have written also need to be updated and improved to continue to uphold the standard of web accessibility? What are the proposed changes and how to prepare? Well, there are 9 new proposed criteria, and each criteria has a lot of detail, but there are a lot of resources available, which I will include in the resource slides at the end of this talk. And what I'm going to do is just briefly talk you through and give you an overview of the changes and the ways in which you can prepare. Starting with guideline 2.4, navigable. This overall is talking about providing ways to help users navigate, find content, and determine where they are on your website. And ways in which you can help them is by doing things such as ensuring things like the keyboard focus indicator is clearly visible and discernible, and just making sure that it's got a good contrast so it's easy to tell that this is the focus state tabbing through the website. Another category, shall I say, is the guideline 2.5, which is input modalities. So this is all about making it easier for users to operate functionality through various inputs beyond the keyboard. So this could be using the mouse to drag, and a particular point that has been highlighted is, if you look further down at pointer, target, spacing. Spacing is key here. So this one talks about ensuring that the target can be easily activated without accidentally activating the one that's near it. So if we use the example of buttons, if you've got 2 buttons close together, and let's say there's really insufficient spacing, so the buttons are very close together, it could be easy for someone to accidentally press the wrong button and cause them to order something they didn't wish to order, or perhaps cancel a service that they never meant to cancel. So spacing is very important to allow people to interact with the technology or interface correctly. Guideline 3.2 is predictable. This talks about making web pages appear and operate in predictable ways. And when reading through the resources available, this, to give an example, made me think of if you were completing a form, that the next button perhaps appears in the bottom right of the web page. You would not want or expect it to then jump to the left-hand side because the content has changed and maybe the designer felt that it would be better on the left on the next page than the right. This is not best practice and not what a user would be expecting. So it's very important here that when users are completing tasks on the website, they are able to find the call to actions or other elements they interact with easily. Guideline 3.3, input assistance. This is about helping users avoid and correct mistakes. Guideline 3.3, input assistance. This is all about helping users avoid and correct mistakes through accessible authentication and avoiding redundant entries, which has a lot of supporting copy that I will link in the resources. So given that we know the 9 criteria that are being added to the WCAG guidelines, how can you prepare? So you should speak to your organisation, your team members, and review existing projects. Do these fall short of the proposed changes? And make a list of it. Then discuss with your team. You could set aside, you could just quickly jump on a call and get these conversations started, or organise a meeting where you can in fact talk about how you're falling short of the guidelines, if this is something that you have to meet by law, whether you're already doing so with your interactions with public sector sites, for example. You could adapt suggestions into your work process. So accessibility shouldn't be difficult. It should be something that is worked into what you're currently doing. So you could talk about how you perhaps add an additional step in your process where you check that the images have alt text, or you, as designers in this example, check that you have sufficient color contrast, and as developers, you can check that you have logical heading structures. Finally, depending on when you're watching this, you have the opportunity to give feedback. The deadline for feedback on the proposed guidelines is the 18th of September. So if any of this has struck a chord with you and you strongly disagree, or you want to make suggestions, you can get in touch with them via GitHub. And lastly, I would like to end with a quote. So this is from a businessman and former CEO of Microsoft, Steve Ballmer, who said, "Accessible design is good design. It benefits people who don't have disabilities as well as people who do. Accessibility is all about removing barriers and providing the benefits of technology for everyone." And if you take away anything from today, I feel like this attitude and approach to accessible design is key. Now, to share with you various resources that can help you on your accessibility journey, I have included a link to the proposed new WCAG 2.2 guidelines, a checklist for both designers and developers on some easy wins, let's say, on accessibility, and also the facts and figures and UK article around the deadline for compliance of public sector websites. Thank you for listening to my talk, and if you've got any questions, let me know.